Hello and welcome to the second tutorial in the series about making HTML5 games with RAID. We're going to continue from where we left off in part one. We have this very simple game where you score 1 point if you hit the mole that keeps coming out of its hole, and you lose a point if you miss it. Now we're going to make it a bit more interesting. We want to have lots of these moles on the screen at the same time. To do this, most people who are familiar with object-oriented programming would immediately think to use a class to store all of the properties and behaviour of the mole. Then you would create more of these instances and you're done. JavaScript, however, is not necessarily an object-oriented language, and you may have better ways of doing the same thing. We have a simple system in RAID of doing something that is similar to a class, but a bit less object-oriented. It's called a behaviour. A scene object in RAID can be assigned one or more behaviours. Behaviours determine how an object behaves, how it responds, and so on. The fact that we can assign one or more behaviours to an object means that we can do some really interesting things. To give you a simple example, let's say that you have a spaceship that moves around and shoots. You could assign it a shooting behaviour and a moving behaviour. Then when you want to create another spaceship that moves around without shooting, you can reuse the moving behaviour without using the shooting behaviour. But for this mole game, we're just going to use one behaviour per object to keep it simple. I'm going to create a different file here. Right-click Awesome Game, New JavaScript File, and I'll call it mole.js. Now, in this blank file, I define a mole function like this. Mole equals function. And in this function, I'm going to define the behaviour of the moles. So, let's go to our main app script, awesome.js. First of all, we want to load this mole.js file into the loading stage of our game. So in the load function, RAID, load script, mole.js. And now here, where we create the scene object for the mole, we tell it to use the mole behaviour, like this. So what happens now is that whenever an event is triggered for our mole scene object, say for example, on move complete, this is triggered for the object, but also for all of its behaviours. This means that we can move this onMoveComplete function in our behaviour file. So let's do it. Cut and paste. Of course, now we want onMoveComplete to be a member of the mole function, so we have to change mole to this. But now, inside the function, we're still referencing a variable called mole with a lowercase m. This variable doesn't exist here, and in fact, if you're using WebStorm, it's going to be underlined. And if you put your mouse over it, it's going to tell you unresolved variable. In fact, this mole variable really represents the scene object that is connected to this mole behaviour. We call it the owner of the behaviour. So we can solve the problem here by replacing all occurrences of mole with this owner. Let's quickly go to Chrome to make sure that it's still working. And yes, it is. Good. So, this code still isn't very tidy. For example, we are defining the state of the mole in awesome.js, then using it in mole.js. That is because we're saying that the state of the mole is a property of the mole scene object, but in reality, it would make more sense to say that it's a property of the mole behaviour. So let's define it in the other file instead. Cut and paste again. By defining it as this.state in our behaviour function, we are saying that now state is a property of our behaviour function. And so we need to reference it as this.state down here too. The goal here is to move everything that deals with our mole object from the main app file into the behaviour file. We do this to encapsulate the code for the object, so that the main app file becomes much cleaner and it's easier to create several instances of our object. And what about the onMouseDown function? Let's do the same with the onMouseDown function. Cut and paste. And now you see we have a bit of a problem here. We are using these score and scoreText variables that were declared as local variables in our main app function. So how can we access them from here? The first step is to make those variables members of the app function, rather than local variables. Back to awesome.js, we replace score with this score. And we replace score text with this score text. So, in mole.js, can we just use this score and this score text? No, of course we can't, because of the meaning of the keyword this in JavaScript. This indicates the current execution context, or to put it more simply, with Wade, it indicates the parent of the function that's being executed. So if score and score text were members of the mole function, we could use this score and this score text here. But they aren't. They're members of the main app function. So how do we access them from here? In Wade, there's a simple way of doing this, which is through Wade app. Wade app indicates the main app function of Wade. So there we go. But wait a minute. If we go back to awesome.js, we are going to have the same problem here. In the holds on mouse down function, we cannot use this score, because when this function is executed, this is the whole object. So again, we replace this with wade.app, and problem solved. Now, there's one more thing that I don't like. The fact that we're having to listen for the onMouseDown event of the mole object here in the main app file. Again, this really should be part of our mole behaviour, so let's cut this from here. And where do we paste it? Well, the most appropriate place would be in a function called onAddToScene. This function is called automatically by Wade whenever the scene object is added to the scene. And again, it isn't mole, but this owner. And you know what? Even this line here that gets it moving at the beginning should probably be in the onAddToScene function of our behaviour. As you can see, here we've moved almost all of the code that deals with our mole object into its behaviour in a separate file. But not quite. There are still a couple of things missing, because it takes 4 lines of code to create a mole. First of all, let me tell you about this trick you can do to set the initial position of an object. Rather than calling setPosition, you can pass the coordinates directly to the constructor of the scene object, like this. And now, this line that deals with the creation of the sprite that's going to be used by our mole object. As you can see, we're passing the sprite as a parameter when we create the scene object. But we don't have to do it necessarily this way. We could also pass no sprites here. By passing 0, for example, and then doing mole, add sprite, sprite. What's the difference? Well, if we do it like this, we can then move this sprite stuff into our behaviour function. In the onAddToScene function, to be precise. This, owner, add sprite. Now we're left with 2 lines of code. Now we're left with 2 lines of code to deal with the creation of this mole. In reality, we don't need this local variable, mole, as it isn't used anywhere else. So we can just do this. And there we go. We can create a mole with a single line of code from our app file. All the logic that deals with what the mole does and what it looks like is in its behaviour file. Let's quickly refresh Chrome to see if we've broken anything. Nope, it's all working. Good. Now we should do exactly the same thing with our whole object. Right-click here on Awesome Game, New, JavaScript File, and we call it whole.js this time. We create a function called whole, capital H, then an onAddToScene function. In the load function of awesome.js, we load the new script. Wade, load script, whole.js. Then we cut and paste these 2 lines that deal with the sprite creation into the new file in the onAddToScene function we just created. And here we do this owner add sprite for both these sprites. Then you see here in awesome.js where we're setting the offsets of the sprites. Well, we can pass the offsets directly into the add sprite function to save some unnecessary typing. and we get rid of those two lines. The onMouseDown function goes straight into the other file, except that now it's this onMouseDown. And the line that we use to listen for the onMouseDown event goes into the onAddToScene function. Again, we'll have to replace whole with this owner. Of course, in the main app file, we have to say that we want to use this whole behaviour like this. We remove the references to the sprites here, as the sprites creation is handled by the behaviour, and pass the behaviour into the constructor of scene object. Finally, we combine these two lines of code, and we're done. Let's check with Chrome once more. All good. We haven't added any new functionality or created any new code as yet. We've just moved some code around. But now we can create as many moles and as many holes as we like. But there is one more problem that we need to address. Let's see what happens if we change the coordinates of our objects. Say that we want to shift everything by 200 units along the x-axis. The mole goes to 250, and the hole, which was at 0, 0, since we didn't specify any coordinates, now goes to 200, 0. However, this won't work. Let's see what happens in Chrome. It's a bit funny. The hole is where it's supposed to be, but the mole goes back to its original position in the middle of the screen and then keeps going up and down. This is because in mole.js, we're using some fixed coordinates as the arguments of our moveTo functions here, here, and here. Instead, we would really like that these coordinates be relative to the owner's position, and it's quite simple to do that. This original position equals this owner get position. Now, this original position is the initial position of our owner, and we move to this original position x. And this original position y. And here. And down here it's going to be plus 50 on the y-axis. And we also remove this offset of 50 units here when we create the object, because we don't need it anymore if we're doing everything relative to the initial position of the mole object. Let's see if it works now. Yes, it does. And now comes the fun part, because we're going to create four of these things. Let's imagine that we would want to lay them out on a grid, so to speak, of size 2x2. So, var grid size equals 2. Then we do two for loops to iterate it all over the cells of the grid. And inside these four loops, we create a hole and a mole for each cell. But where do we create it? So let's say that a cell is 300 wide and tall. Var cell size equals 300. So if we want the grid to be centered at 0, 0, the coordinates that we want to use are var x equals I minus grid size divided by 2 plus 0.5 times cell size. Var y equals j minus grid size divided by 2 plus 0.5 times cell size. I'm not going to go through the maths here, but it's pretty simple anyway. Now let's try it in Chrome. We might have to move our score object up a bit, say at minus 350 for now. Then we'll think of how to calculate a better position for it later on. Okay, that's cool, isn't it? So our game's become a bit more interesting and a little bit more challenging. Now that we've got some solid foundations, we're going to make it much more enjoyable to play in our next video tutorial. So once again, thank you for watching and see you soon.